This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Kingdom of Bulgaria participated in World War I on the side of the Central Powers from 14 October 1915, when the country declared war on Serbia, until 30 September 1918, when the belligerent parties signed the Armistice of Thessalonica in the aftermath of the Balkan Wars of 1912 and 1913. Bulgaria found itself isolated on the international scene, surrounded by hostile neighbors and deprived of the support of the great powers. Anti-Bulgarian sentiment grew particularly in France and Russia, whose political circles blamed the country for the dissolution of the Balkan League, an alliance of Balkan states directed against the Ottoman Empire. The failure of Bulgarian foreign policy turned revanchism into a focus of Bulgaria's external relations when the First World War started in July 1914. Bulgaria, still recovering from the negative economic and demographic impact of recent wars, avoided direct involvement in the new conflict by declaring neutrality. Strategic geographic location and a strong military establishment made the country a desired ally for both warring coalitions, but Bulgaria's regional aspirations were difficult to satisfy because they included territorial claims against four Balkan countries. As the war progressed, the Central Powers of Austria-Hungary and the German Empire found themselves in a better position to fulfill Bulgarian demands and persuaded the country to join their cause in September 1915. Though the smallest member of the Central Powers in area and in population, Bulgaria made vital contributions to their common war effort. Its entry to the war heralded the defeat of Serbia, thwarted the foreign policy goals of Romania, and ensured the continuation of the Ottoman war effort by providing a geographical conduit for material assistance from Germany to Istanbul. Though the Balkan theater of the war saw successful campaigns of rapid movement in 1915 and 1916, the conflict degraded into a state of attritional trench warfare on both the northern and the southern Bulgarian fronts after most Bulgarian territorial aspirations had been satisfied. This period of the war substantially weakened the Bulgarian economy, created various supply problems, and reduced the health and morale of Bulgarian troops on the front lines. Under these circumstances, the Allied armies based in Greece, composed of contingents from many Allied countries, managed to break through on the Macedonian front during the Vardar Offensive September 1918 and cause the rapid collapse of a part of the Bulgarian army. There followed an open military rebellion and the proclamation of a republic by the rebellious troops at Radomir. Bulgaria, forced to seek peace, accepted an armistice with the Allies on 30 September 1918 for the second time in half a decade. The country found itself in the midst of a national catastrophe. Tsar Ferdinand I assumed responsibility for his country's foreign policy and military failures and abdicated in favor of his son Boris III on 3 October 1918. The Treaty of Neuilly 1919 marked the formal conclusion of Bulgaria's participation in World War I. Stipulations of the treaty included the return of all occupied territories, the cession of additional territories, and the payment of heavy war reparations. Contents 1. Background 11. The Balkan Wars. 12. Bulgaria in the aftermath of the Balkan Wars. 121. Economic situation. 122. Foreign policy. 2. Bulgaria at the beginning of the First World War. 21. Neutrality. 22. Foreign diplomatic activity in Bulgaria. 3. The end of neutrality. 31. The Bulgarian summer of 1915-32. Bulgaria enters the war. 4. The Bulgarian Army. 41. Organization and state of the army. 42. Mobilization. 5. Bulgaria at war. 51. Military operations. 511. Conquest of Serbia. 512. Establishment and development of the Macedonian Front during 1916-513. The Romanian Campaign. 514-1917. Stalemate on the Macedonian Front. 515-1918. End of the war. 6. The interwar years. 7. Images. 8. See also. 9. In literature. 10. Footnotes. 11. References. Background. The Balkan Wars. Main articles. First Balkan War and Second Balkan War. Territorial changes following the two Balkan Wars. When Bulgaria proclaimed its independence from the Ottoman Empire on 22 September 1908, its status was promoted to that of a kingdom, and Prince Ferdinand of Bulgaria assumed the title of Tsar. The country was now able to focus on completing its national unification by turning its attention toward the lands populated by Bulgarians that remained under Ottoman control. To achieve its goals, the Bulgarian government, under Prime Minister Ivan Gashov, approached the governments of the other Balkan countries in hopes of creating an alliance directed against the Ottomans. His efforts culminated in a series of bilateral treaties concluded in 1912 to form the the Balkan League by summer of the same year, Ottoman grip on their Balkan provinces deteriorated rapidly in Albania and Macedonia, where open rebellions had erupted. The Allies decided to exploit the vulnerable state of the Ottoman Empire and declared war on it in October 1912. The opening stages of the First Balkan War began with decisive Allied victories in both Thrace and Macedonia within a month. The Ottomans found themselves driven back by the Bulgarians to within 40 kilometers of Constantinople and badly beaten by the Serbians and the Greeks. A short armistice brought no conclusion to the conflict, and fighting once again broke out in January 1913. A major Ottoman counter-offensive was defeated by the Bulgarians, who also seized the fortress of Adrianople in March and finally forced the Ottoman Empire to admit defeat and return to the peace table. While the Bulgarian army was still fighting, a new challenge arose from the north. Romania demanded territorial compensations from Bulgaria in return for its neutrality during the war. A conference, which was held in St. Petersburg, sought to resolve the dispute by rewarding Romania the Bulgarian town of Silistra, but this decision greatly antagonized both countries and sowed the seeds of further enmity between them. The formal ending of the war was marked by the signing of the Treaty of London of 1913, which awarded all Ottoman territory to the west of the Midia-Enos line, with the exception of Albania. To the Allies, the treaty failed to make clear provisions for the division of the former Ottoman territories between the victors, which brought about the dissolution of the Balkan League. Gushov foresaw this outcome, which signaled the collapse of his goal of forming a permanent alliance directed against the Ottoman Empire, and resigned from his post as prime minister. He was replaced by the hard-liner Stoyan Dinev. The new government was not willing to compromise with Bulgarian claims in Macedonia, and neither were Serbia and Greece, whose interests were frustrated by the creation of an Albanian state. Russia, which was viewed as the patron of the Balkan League, was unable to control the situation and settle the disputes between the Allies. The failure of Russian diplomacy, and the Entente Cordiale among Russia, France, and Great Britain that stood behind it, was a victory for Austria-Hungary, which sought to undermine the unity between the Balkan countries. In June, the new Bulgarian government was asked by the Bulgarian General Staff to either take aggressive action or order demobilization within 10 days. The senior Bulgarian commanders were concerned by the new alliance between Serbia and Greece and the growing restlessness in the army, which had been in the field since September 1912. Dinev was preparing to leave for Russia, where a new attempt to solve the problem was made by Tsar Ferdinand and General Mihail Savov, who decided to make a demonstration to Serbia, Greece and the Entente by ordering two of the Bulgarian armies to attack and consolidate their positions in Macedonia on 16 June. More than a day later, Dinev ordered Savov to stop the fighting, and the latter obeyed, despite orders for the continuation of the attack given to him by the Tsar. The Serbians and Greeks, however, were not willing to let this opportunity pass and declared war on Bulgaria, perceiving an opportunity to acquire southern Dobruja. Romania also invaded Bulgaria. The Romanian force met with almost no resistance and was soon followed by the Ottoman Empire, which restored its control over eastern Thrace. A punch cartoon of the Second Balkan War. The eruption of this Second Balkan War tore a rift in the relations between Bulgaria and Russia and led to the downfall of the Dinev government. Amidst the news of Bulgarian defeats in the field, a new liberal coalition government under Vasil Radoslavov took control and immediately began seeking a diplomatic solution to the crisis, looking primarily towards Germany and Austria-Hungary for help. Direct negotiations with Serbia and Greece proved inconclusive, but following Bulgaria's offer to cede southern Dobruja to Romania, both sides agreed to begin peace talks in Bucharest at the same time. The Bulgarian army managed to stabilize the Serbian and Greek fronts and even go on the offensive. Bulgarian forces threatened to encircle the Greek army completely, but with the Romanians only a few kilometers from the Bulgarian capital of Sofia and the Ottomans in good position to invade the whole of southeastern Bulgaria, the warring countries concluded an armistice in July 1913. Following the cessation of hostilities, the peace talks in Bucharest resumed. The Bulgarian delegation found itself in almost complete isolation, with only the partial support of Russia and Austria-Hungary, which forced it to accept the coercive conditions of its opponents and sign the Treaty of Bucharest of 1913. The treaty required Bulgaria to cede southern Dobruja, most of Macedonia including the uncontested zone that had previously been bestowed to it by the 1912 treaty between Bulgaria and Serbia, and the town of Kavala. The peace treaty with the the Ottomans had to be dealt with on a bilateral basis initially, the Bulgarian diplomacy maintained the position that the question about the possession of Adrianople and Eastern Thrace was an international matter resolved by the terms of the Treaty of London of 1913, but this line soon had to be abandoned due to the lack of support by the Great Powers and their unwillingness to pressure the Ottoman Empire. The resulting Treaty of Constantinople of 1913 restored to the Ottomans most of the lands they had re-occupied during the Second Balkan War. During the talks, the Radoslavov government for the first time sought to recover and strengthen the relations with the Ottomans by discussing an alliance directed against Serbia and Greece, but no concrete results were achieved at that point. Bulgaria, in the aftermath of the Balkan Wars, Vasil Radoslavov c. 1915, Prime Minister from 1913 to 1918. The outcome of the Second Balkan War negated almost all of the territorial gains that Bulgaria secured during the First Balkan War. The failed effort to bring all Bulgarians under a single national government led to a massive influx of over 120,000 Bulgarian refugees from Eastern Thrace and the parts of Macedonia that remained under Serbian and Greek rule. The Radoslavov government faced the uneasy task of integrating the new population and the acquired territories that were not ceded back, as well as rebuilding the economy and the military potential of the country. Internal bickering within the People's Liberal Party, one of the three governing coalition parties, and the lack of a majority in parliament forced the dissolution of the legislative body. General elections were called for the pre-war borders of Bulgaria in November 1913 and held for the first time under nationwide proportional representation. The government parties gained only 97 seats as compared to the 107 seats of their opponents, which prompted a new resignation of the government in December. Tsar Ferdinand held consultations with several important politicians, but once again preferred to appoint a government with Radoslavov as prime minister and dissolve the newly elected parliament when the next elections were held in March 1914. The population of the new territories was allowed to participate even though many participants had not yet received Bulgarian citizenship during the campaign. The spokesmen of the opposition parties were practically prevented from campaigning in these lands on the grounds of the alleged threat to their safety. Ottoman officials, however, were allowed to visit the local Muslim population and urge them to vote for the government despite these and other extreme measures. The liberal parties gained 116 seats, as many as their opponents, and their numbers were increased by another 16 following the completion of the verification process. The government was finally able to focus its attention on more pressing internal and external matters. Radoslavov, however, remained handicapped by this fragile majority and was often forced to compromise with his coalition partners, falsify election results, or simply neglect parliament. Economic situation. Bulgarian participation in the Balkan Wars disrupted the expansion of the Bulgarian economy and proved crippling for public finances, with the financial cost of the war against the Ottoman Empire alone at over 1.3 billion francs. Agriculture, which was the leading sector of the economy, was badly affected, and overall production was reduced by about 9% compared to 1911. Still, the country avoided a large food crisis. Thousands of peasant workers engaged in agricultural activities became casualties during the wars. The number of available horses, sheep, cattle, and livestock was between 20% and 40% lower. The single most damaging event was the loss of southern Dobruja. It had accounted for 20% of Bulgarian grain production before the wars and contained the largest and most developed Bulgarian farming communities. This, combined with bad weather, held the harvest of all crops to 79% of the pre-war level in 1914. Unlike the agriculture sector, Bulgarian industry was less affected, even though problems occurred due to its complete dependence on foreign imports of machinery and spare parts. Production registered a modest decline and was able to maintain a constant level of capital investment that led to recovery of the sector as early as 1914. External trade fell drastically in 1913, with exports reduced by 40% and imports by 11%. This led to a soaring trade deficit of over 87 million levs by 1914. Before the war, grain had been a leading Bulgarian export commodity, with the most productive area being Dobruja. The state took special care for the development of the region. It built railways to carry grain and other exports to the port of Varna, whose facilities had been developed at great cost in 1912. It handled more goods than Salonika following the Second Balkan War. These advantages were lost because the port was deprived of its hinterland, and the Romanian border now ran only 15 Kilometers away, the new lands gained in the south were mountainous and much poorer. They provided an outlet to the Aegean Sea at the port of Didiagach, but the railway needed to reach it passed through Ottoman territory still. Western Thrace in particular was famed for its production of high-quality tobacco, which proved to be a valuable asset. Foreign policy dealing with the international isolation that had befallen Bulgaria was a major priority of the Radoslavov government. This included re-establishing diplomatic relations with Bulgaria's neighbors, first with the Ottoman Empire in September 1913, then with Serbia in December of the same year and Greece in March 1914. Nevertheless, relations with the Balkan states remained strained due to their fear of Bulgarian revisionism and negative public opinion in Bulgaria of the country's former allies. A friendly gesture was made when Mihail Majdarov, Dimitar Stanchov and Rodko Dmitriev, who were well known for their pro-Entente attitude, were appointed ambassadors to London, Paris and St. Petersburg. This showed that the liberal government was not ready to burn its bridges to the Entente powers. The Central Powers, on the other hand, were not yet willing to step into an open alliance with Bulgaria, as this would have alienated the other Balkan countries that Germany and Austria-Hungary had interest in, particularly Romania and Greece. The most active Entente power in the Balkans was Russia, which sought to limit Austro-Hungarian influence in the area by creating a new Balkan League that was to include Serbia, Montenegro and possibly Romania and Bulgaria. The latter was not in the center of these plans, though its participation was viewed as attractive enough. Russian diplomacy spent much more time and effort courting Romania, which achieved little practical results, but stirred negative emotions and further alienated Bulgaria. Hints towards Serbia that it should make at least minor concessions to Bulgaria only met with stubborn resistance supported by Greece. The Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Sazonov decided that the only way to influence Bulgaria without harming Russian relations with its neighbors was through financial pressure on the Radoslavov government and its deposition by a pro-Entente government. France and the United Kingdom were willing to let Russia deal with Bulgaria and preferred not to intervene directly. Prime Minister Radoslavov, on the other hand, partially sought the support of Great Britain through the Bulgarian representative in St. Petersburg, General Dmitriev, who asked the British ambassador to mediate the relationship between Bulgaria and Russia. The individual approached by General Dmitriev, George Buchanan, politely refused any involvement, but hinted to Sazonov that he should not risk curtailing Entente influence in Bulgaria by assuming a hard line toward the country. The most important task that faced the Radoslavov government in its foreign policy following the Treaty of Bucharest was to secure a loan that could provide the funds needed to pay the financial cost of the Balkan Wars, develop the new territories and continue paying a government debt of over 700 million golden leva. The difficult task was entrusted to Foreign Minister Nikola Genadiev and Finance Minister Dimitar Tantchev, who were first dispatched to France, which held a considerable chunk of the Bulgarian public debt and from which Bulgaria had usually obtained loans before the Balkan Wars. The French refused to extend more loans, due to Russian pressure, despite the fact that the Bulgarian representatives were ready to accept certain unfavorable conditions and that French banks were simultaneously granting loans to Serbia, Greece, Romania and the Ottoman Empire in October 1913. Tantchev managed to secure a short-term loan of 30 million leva from Austrian banks, but the sum was far from sufficient. In February 1914, the Bulgarians again turned to France and were met with unacceptable conditions. Tantchev, assisted by the German and Austro-Hungarian representatives in Sofia, Gustav Michaels and Count Adam Ternovsky von Tarnow, opened negotiations with the German Discount Gesellschaft Bank in early 1914. Russia and France were aware of the talks, but initially dismissed the possibility of their successful conclusion. It was only in April, when the Bulgarian and German representatives had reached an understanding on the basic points of the loan, that the Entente realized that through its hard line it had pushed Bulgaria toward a serious commitment to the Central Powers. The Russian ambassador to Sofia urged the Bulgarian parliamentary opposition to resist the Radoslavov government's intention and personally met with Tsar Ferdinand, whom he promised a French loan in exchange for the removal of Radoslavov. An offer for a loan from the French bank Perrier was also made, but these efforts from the Entente powers came too late and failed to change Bulgarian intentions. In July 1914, a consortium of German banks led by the Discounto Gesellschaft granted a 500 million golden leva loan to Bulgaria under harsh conditions. The sum would be received in two installments installments of $250 million each and had to be repaid within 50 years with an annual interest of 5%. The Bulgarians were obliged to grant the German consortium the contract for the construction of a new port in Porto Lagos and a railway leading to it. The Germans were also to take over the running of the state mines in Pernik and Bubov Dol. The government managed to pass the loan through a vote in parliament despite furious opposition. The debate took place among numerous fist fights. The Prime Minister was seen to wave a revolver above his head. The government claimed the loan had been approved by show of hands. The loan agreement was a heavy defeat for Russian and French diplomacy, whose attention was also diverted by the July crisis surrounding the assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria. At this point, it did not yield a firm commitment by Tsar Ferdinand and Bulgaria to the cause of the Central Powers. Bulgaria at the beginning of the First World War. On 28 June 1914, Gavrilo Princip, a Bosnian Serb student and member of Young Bosnia, assassinated the heir to the Austro-Hungarian throne, the Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria in Sarajevo, Bosnia. This began a period of diplomatic maneuvering between Austria-Hungary, Germany, Russia, France and Britain called the July Crisis. Wanting to end Serbian interference in Bosnia conclusively, Austria-Hungary delivered the July Ultimatum to Serbia, a series of 10 demands that were intentionally meant to be unacceptable in order to precipitate a war with Serbia. When Serbia acceded to only 8 of the 10 demands levied against it in the ultimatum, Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia on 28 July 1914. Within days, the conflict spread to most of Europe and encompassed all of the major great powers. Many other European countries, however, including Italy and Romania, who had previously been affiliated with one of the major war alliances, preferred to stay neutral. Neutrality immediately following the outbreak of hostilities, the Bulgarian Tsar and Prime Minister decided to declare a policy of strict and loyal neutrality, a stance that was popular with both ruling and opposition parties. Radoslavov also realized that the lack of proper diplomatic preparation and support from some of the great powers had been a major cause for the Bulgarian defeat in 1913, and he intended not to repeat the same mistakes in order to adjust to the new reality of war. The government managed to pass a bill for the declaration of martial law and a bill for an internal loan of 50 million leva for the needs of the army. The news of Bulgarian neutrality was received well in Entente capitals, even if their approach towards the country differed initially. These powers thought the war would be short. Bulgaria was not given an important role in their plans, as its diplomatic isolation was viewed as weakness. Romania, with its large population and strategic position on the flank of Austria-Hungary, was reckoned a more attractive ally. This was especially the case in France, whose ambassador in Bucharest was heavily engaged in fighting German and Austrian influence in the country. Great Britain also hoped that a Romanian entry into the war on its side would force Bulgaria and even the Ottoman Empire to at least remain neutral. While Greece might brave itself to support Serbia openly, the mood in St. Petersburg was far less optimistic, as the Russians were aware that the price tag of Romania's entry into the war would include Bessarabia and also feared that its intervention would only extend the already huge Eastern Front. The initial reaction of the Central Powers to the declaration of neutrality was similar to that of the Entente. Germany and Austria-Hungary in particular were weighing the possibility of encouraging immediate Bulgarian intervention against Serbia, because the neutrality of Italy and Romania, countries that had been their allies prior to the outbreak of the war, was a major defeat for German and Austrian diplomacy. Radoslavov, who was generally pro-German, engaged in talks with the German and Austro-Hungarian ambassadors as early as July 1914, but in the end he preferred to reaffirm Bulgaria's neutrality on other diplomatic fronts. The Prime Minister achieved greater results with the signing of a secret treaty between Bulgaria and the Ottoman Empire on 6 August 1914. This was a mutual defense pact that would come into effect if either party was attacked by another Balkan power. Both countries pledged not to attack other Balkan countries without consultation with each other. In the absence of such consultation, the parties pledged benevolent neutrality in such a conflict. Bulgaria additionally agreed to notify the Ottoman Empire of any impending military mobilization. The treaty was kept in deep secrecy, and it remained unknown to most other powers. Germany was made aware of its existence in December 1914 when the Ottomans entered the war on the side of the Central Powers. In October 1914, Bulgaria reaffirmed its neutrality. Foreign diplomatic activity in Bulgaria. The contested and uncontested zone in Vardar, Macedonia German and Austro-Hungarian diplomacy began probing the Bulgarian government's intentions immediately following the initial declaration of neutrality. Both presented Tsar Ferdinand with a draft of a military agreement between the Central Powers and Bulgaria. The German ambassador Mikhaels also initiated negotiations for a military agreement with Prime Minister Radoslavov in August 1914. These steps did not lead to any concrete commitments by the Bulgarian government, which realized the country was not yet ready for a war. The Austrian defeat in the Battle of Cer in Serbia also undermined the attempts of Austria-Hungary to secure Bulgaria openly on its side in early September 1914. Bulgaria was visited by Duke John Albert of Mecklenburg as a personal representative of Kaiser Wilhelm II, but he also failed to sway the firm position of the Bulgarian government. The Entente diplomacy did not sit idly by. Either the Russian government was still trying to build a new Balkan League that would include Serbia, Montenegro and Bulgaria. On 31 July, Sazonov asked the Serbian government to determine what territory it would be willing to give to Bulgaria in exchange for its neutrality or military cooperation, but instead received no reaction from the Serbian prime minister. A few days later, Sazonov suggested that Serbia should cede parts of the uncontested zone to gain Bulgaria for the war with Austria-Hungary and eventually cede the entire zone if the war ended in favor of the Entente. Though the Serbians were not willing to antagonize their Russian patrons, they decided not to yield. Serbian policy on this matter was not led by ethnographic motives, but by a geopolitical theory that held that the dominant position in the Balkan Peninsula would be held by the country that controlled the valleys of the rivers Morava and Vardar. Thus the Serbians preferred to face the Austro-Hungarians on their own in exchange for a benevolent Bulgarian neutrality, for which they offered to cede about a quarter of the uncontested zone, but keep total control of the Vardar. This, however, did not deter Sazonov from ordering Savinsky to offer vague territorial acquisitions to Ferdinand and Radoslavov in exchange for their cooperation. The Russians were also restrained in their activity due to their allies, especially France, which preferred the cooperation of Romania rather than Bulgaria. Fresh diplomatic initiatives from France were expected following the appointment on 26 August 1914 of Théophile Delcasse, a diplomat with extensive experience regarding Balkan matters, as French Foreign Minister. French diplomacy, like Russian diplomacy, also toyed with the idea of a new Balkan League directed against the Ottoman and believed that Bulgaria could be offered Eastern Thrace up to the Mytilene-Enos line. Still, its prestige and influence were greatly reduced in Bulgaria. Due to France's behavior during the Balkan Wars, this forced the French to admit the leading role of Russia in all attempts of gaining Bulgarian support and limit themselves with cautious support of Russian proposals. The British government thought it best to avoid any complications in the Balkans. The feeling was that a Balkan alliance of neutral countries was better suited to its interests, which conflicted with Russian ideas of Bulgarian military support in exchange for territorial concessions by its neighbours. Great Britain was thus unwilling to pressure Bulgaria's neighbours to satisfy Bulgarian territorial demands in order to further Entente ideas of a Balkan League. The British government dispatched the Liberal MPs Noel and Charles Buxton to meet unofficially with leading Bulgarian statesmen. When they arrived in Bulgaria, the brothers were greeted warmly and first met in September with Tsar Ferdinand, Prime Minister Radoslavov and Minister Tantchev, from whom they received firm assurances of Bulgaria's strict neutrality. After that, they turned their attention to the Bulgarian opposition leaders and met with Alexander Stamboliski, Ivan Gashov, Yanko Sakazov and others during their stay in the country. The Buxtons found the Bulgarians, even the pro-Entente ones, to be very cautious when it came to aligning the country to Britain. The unofficial character of the visit also made it look like it was a private enterprise rather than one backed by serious British intentions. The brothers, however, continued their work in Bulgaria and advocated a declaration by the Entente powers promising support for Bulgaria's claim to the uncontested zone of Macedonia in return for its benevolent neutrality towards Romania and Serbia. Despite having the support of all Allied representatives in Sofia, the Buxtons were unable to impress the British Prime Minister H.H. Asquith, who considered it out of the question to force Serbia to cede land. Shortly after, Noel Buxton was shot and seriously wounded by a Turkish assassin while visiting Bucharest. He and his brother were forced to cease their diplomatic activities temporarily in October 1914. The entry of the Ottoman Empire into the war on the side of the Central Powers considerably altered the political and military situation in the Balkans. Radoslavov realized that Bulgaria's value as a potential ally of either of the warring sides had now increased substantially due to its strategic geographic position and considerable military potential. The new status quo also increased the bargaining power of Germany and Austria-Hungary in the remaining neutral Balkan capitals, but it did not enhance the Entente's cause in its negotiations with Bulgaria. All the Allies could do was hand a note to Radoslavov promising territorial gains in exchange of strict neutrality and further gains if Bulgaria joined the war against the Austro-Hungarian and Ottoman Empire. The Bulgarian Prime Minister could not accept such a vague offer in the face of continuous determination by Serbia not to cede lands to Bulgaria. On 9 December, the Allies, who realized their previous mistake, handed a new declaration promising Bulgaria Ottoman Eastern Thrace up to the Midia Enos line and fair territorial gains in Macedonia in exchange for its neutrality. Radoslavov again refused to make any commitments and confirmed his intention to keep Bulgaria on the already established course. The end of neutrality as 1914 came to an end, Bulgaria remained on the sidelines of World War I. Popular opinion lacked enthusiasm for entering the conflict and supported the country's stance of neutrality at this point. Prime Minister Radoslavov adopted a wait-and-see policy while at the same time he successfully probed the abilities of the warring alliances to satisfy Bulgarian territorial ambitions. A final commitment could be made only when one of the sides had gained a decisive military advantage and had firmly guaranteed the fulfillment of Bulgarian national ideals on the battlefields far from Bulgaria. The war had entered a long period of stalemate with no side appearing to gain the upper hand on the Western Front. In February 1915, the French failed to break the German lines at the First Battle of Champagne, while further attempts at the Second Battle of Artois during May also came to an unsuccessful conclusion. The Germans had decided to focus their efforts on the Eastern Front, where they had considerable success against the Russians in the Second Battle of the Masurian Lakes in February 1915, but their gains were largely negated at the Siege of Pshemyshl in March. The Germans and Austrians then undertook new counterattacks to restore their positions. Finally, in May 1915, Italy entered the war on the side of the Entente. Under these circumstances, the military and political value of the neutral Balkan countries increased significantly. The military successes of each warring side were often a major asset in their diplomatic courtship of Bulgaria. Thus, when Pshemyshl fell and the Anglo-French landed in the Dardanelles, Radoslavov expressed greater interest in negotiations with the Entente. The leading role of Britain in the Gallipoli campaign of 1915 made it a natural driving force behind the revival of Entente attempts to acquire Bulgaria as an ally. The British realized that the key to winning Bulgaria was in Vardar, Macedonia, and they suggested to Sazonov that Serbia should be prepared to cede the uncontested zone in exchange for Austrian territory. The Russian foreign minister decided to stand behind this proposition, even though he found it rather vague, as long as it could turn Bulgaria against the Ottoman Empire. Serbia, however, remained adamant, and Crown Prince George of Serbia even declared that the country would rather give up Bosnia than hand over Vardar Macedonia to Bulgaria. At the same time, Germany hoped in vain to use the payment of a 150 million installment of the 1914 loan as means of exerting influence on the Bulgarian government, and Radoslavov turned his attention in an unexpected direction by sending Genevieve to Rome. The purpose of this move was unclear to foreign observers, and speculation soon arose that Radoslavov was only trying to remove a potent contender for his post. Whatever the reason, Genevieve became convinced that Italy was preparing to throw in its lot with the Entente. During his two-month stay in the Italian capital, Radoslavov was not pleased by this news and thought that his coalition partner might undermine the ruling government coalition. Had he read the report on his foreign visit to the Council of Ministers of Bulgaria to prevent this, the Prime Minister made sure that Genevieve would not be able to share his impressions with his colleagues, and most ministers were left completely unaware of his report. The Foreign Minister's prediction about Italy entering the war on the side of the Entente became reality in May 1915, but it also presented an unforeseen complication for the Allied diplomacy, as Italy and Serbia both had claims in Dalmatia, which made the latter even more uncompromising when asked to make concession to Bulgaria. On 29 May, not long after Italy's entry into the war, the Allied representatives in Sofia independently presented an identical note proposing an alliance in exchange for Bulgaria's immediate attack on the Ottoman Empire. In return, Bulgaria would receive Eastern Thrace to the Enos-Midia line and the uncontested zone in Macedonia. Bulgaria could occupy Thrace at its earliest convenience, and the gains in Macedonia were contingent upon Serbia receiving land in Bosnia and an outlet on the Adriatic Adriatic coast, the Allies also promised substantial financial assistance and full support in pressuring Greece to cede Kavala, whereas Romania was to return southern Dobruja in many respects. This proposal represented a turning point in the relationship between the Entente and Bulgaria, as it offered for the first time a reward close to satisfying all Bulgarian demands. The Allied proposals, however, had been coordinated with neither Serbia nor Greece and provoked fierce protests from those countries. Naturally, this left the Bulgarians with serious doubts about Allied intentions. Radoslavov's reply was received only on 15 June, and although friendly, it asked for further clarifications and no commitments at all. In addition, the changing military situation also affected Bulgarian opinions, as Italy's entry into the war failed to break Austria-Hungary, the Russians suffered reverses in Galicia, and the Allied landings in the Dardanelles proved less successful than expected. The Central Powers were aware of the Allied overtures to Bulgaria, and only a few days before the Allied proposal of 29 May came up with an offer of their own, the Austrian and Germans would guarantee both the contested and uncontested zones of Macedonia in exchange for Bulgarian neutrality, and if a war with Greece and Romania resulted, then Bulgaria could expect the lands that it had lost in 1913. Tsar Ferdinand issued a speedy reply, but at this point he too preferred not to commit the country to the war. The Allies struggled to give a unified reply to Radoslavov's questions as their positions began to diverge. Britain's Foreign Minister Edward Grey had doubts about the true Bulgarian intentions and wished to scale down the promises made to Bulgaria. His views, however, were met with disapproval even in his own cabinet. David Lloyd George and Winston Churchill thought that a high price, mostly at Greek expense, was worth paying. France and Russia feared that Grey's ideas might push Ferdinand and Radoslavo further away, and also disagreed. Unlike their British colleague, both Sazonov and Delcasse were also willing to exert greater pressure on Greece to make appropriate concessions in exchange for future compensations in Asia Minor. The Russians wanted to put a time limit for Bulgarian acceptance, because its military intervention would be most useful before the autumn mud put an end to the heavy fighting on the Eastern Front. As the spring of 1915 passed, the Allies missed the most promising opportunity of winning Bulgaria for their cause, the Bulgarian summer of 1915. Tsar Ferdinand in a general's uniform. The summer months of 1915 saw a decisive clash between the diplomacy of the Entente and the Central Powers. Marcel Dunin, a young French historian, reporter for the French press and witness of the critical events, summarized the importance of this period for the entire course of the war by simply naming it the Bulgarian summer of 1915. Bulgaria's strategic geographic position and strong army now more than ever could provide a decisive advantage to the side that managed to win its support for the Allies. Bulgaria could provide needed support to Serbia, shore up Russia's defences, and effectively neutralise the Ottoman Empire, while it could ensure the defeat of Serbia for the Central Powers, cut off Russia from its allies, and open the way to Constantinople, thus securing the continuous Ottoman war effort. Both sides had promised more or less the fulfilment of Bulgaria's national aspirations, and the only problem facing the Bulgarian Prime Minister was how to secure maximum gains in exchange for minimum commitments. During this time, many Entente and Central Powers dignitaries were sent to Sofia in an effort to secure Bulgaria's friendship and support. Allied representatives met with the leaders of the Bulgarian opposition parties and also provided generous financial support for opposition newspapers. They even attempted to bribe high-ranking government officials. Germany and Austria-Hungary were not willing to remain on the sidelines and dispatched to Bulgaria Duke John Albert of Mecklenburg, the former ambassador to the Ottoman Empire Hans Freiherr von Wangenheim, and Prince Hohenlohe, who openly declared that after the defeat of Serbia, Bulgaria would assume hegemony of the Balkans. What seized Bulgarian interest the most was indeed the balance of military power. The situation on the major European fronts was at that time developing markedly in favor of the Central Powers, and while the Allied operation in Gallipoli turned into a costly stalemate, the Russians were being driven out of Galicia and Poland. Under these circumstances, the Allies were hoping to secure Bulgaria at last. Still, it took Entente diplomacy more than a month to give an answer to Radoslavov's questions, and the reply proved far from satisfactory. In reality, it hardly differed from the offer the Allies presented in May. Once again, the promises lacked a clear guarantee that Serbia would cede the desired lands, and there was not even a mention of southern Dobruja in the eyes of the Bulgarians. This was a manifestation of Entente helplessness in the face of the conflicting ambitions of its smaller Balkan allies. The diplomatic diplomatic positions of the Central Powers in Sofia were strengthened immensely, forcing the Bulgarian Tsar and Prime Minister to assume a course towards a final alignment of the country to the side of the Central Powers in August. A Bulgarian military mission led by Colonel Petr Ganchev, a former military attaché in Berlin, was dispatched to Germany to work out the details for a military convention almost at the same time. The Minister of War, Lieutenant General Ivan Fichev, resigned and was replaced as minister by the pro-German Major General Nikola Zhekov. Radoslavov also entered into talks with the Ottoman Empire, trying to gain concessions in exchange for Bulgarian benevolent neutrality in this situation. Germany, unlike the Allies, was able to persuade its ally at least to consider seriously the notion of ceding some land to gain Bulgarian support. Still, the Ottomans were willing to conclude the deal only after Bulgaria entered into an agreement with the Central Powers throughout the month of August. The Allied diplomatic activity grew more incoherent. British and French diplomats began to realize that in the face of the stubborn Serbian and Greek refusals of any immediate concessions, that the best they could hope for was to keep Bulgaria neutral in the face of its diplomatic failure. The Entente even resorted to more unusual means of keeping Bulgaria on the sidelines. The Allies and their Bulgarian political sympathizers attempted to buy out the country's grain harvest and create a food crisis. This affair was revealed to the Bulgarian government, and the perpetrators were arrested. Entente diplomats continued to pressure the Serbian government, finally forcing it to assume a more yielding attitude. On 1 September 1915, the Serbian Prime Minister agreed to cede about half of the uncontested zone, but he demanded that Serbia should keep most of the land to the west of the Vardar, including the towns of Prilep, Ohrid, and Velez. In return for these territorial concessions, the Allied powers had to allow Serbia to absorb Croatia and Slovenia and demand Bulgaria to attack the Ottoman Empire. The Serbian offer was unacceptable, and most of its demands were rejected at the same time. The Entente was unaware that the negotiations between Bulgaria and the Central Powers had reached a critical phase. Bulgaria enters the war. Serbian territories guaranteed to Bulgaria with the Treaty of Amity and Alliance on 6 September 1915. Bulgaria formalized its affiliation with the Central Powers by concluding three separate documents of political and military character. The first document was signed by Prime Minister Radoslavov and the German ambassador Mikaheles in Sofia. The Treaty of Amity and Alliance between the Kingdom of Bulgaria and the German Empire. It consisted of five articles that were to remain in force for 5 years according to the treaty. Each of the contracting sides agreed not to enter an alliance or agreement directed against the other. Germany was obliged to protect Bulgarian political independence and territorial integrity against all attack that could result without provocation on the side of the Bulgarian government. In exchange, Bulgaria was obligated to take action against any of its neighboring states if they attacked Germany. Bulgarian reservists at the train station in Sofia, boarding for the front. The second important document was a secret annex to the Treaty of Alliance. It specified the territorial acquisitions that Germany guaranteed to Bulgaria, the whole of Vardar Macedonia, including the so-called contested and uncontested zones, plus the part of Old Serbia to the east of the Morava River in case Romania or Greece attacked Bulgaria or its allies without provocation. Germany would agree to Bulgarian annexation of the lands lost to these countries by the Treaty of Bucharest of 1913, and to a rectification of the Bulgarian-Romanian border as delimited by the Treaty of Berlin of 1878. In addition, Germany and Austria-Hungary guaranteed the Bulgarian government a war loan of 200 million francs, and in case the war lasted longer than 4 months, they guaranteed an additional supplementary loan. The third document was concluded at the German Eastern Military Headquarters in Pless by the Chief of the German General Staff Erich von Falkenhayn, the Chief of the Austro-Hungarian General Staff Count Franz Konrad von Hotzendorf, and the Delegate of the Bulgarian Government, Colonel Petr Ganchev. It was a military convention detailing the plan for the final defeat and conquest of Serbia. Germany and Austria-Hungary were obliged to act against Serbia within 30 days of the signing of the convention, while Bulgaria had to do the same within 35 days of that date. Germany and Austria-Hungary were to field at least 6 infantry divisions for the attack, and Bulgaria at least 4 infantry divisions according to their established tables and organization. All these forces were to be placed under the command of Generalfeldmarschall August von Mackensen, whose task was to fight the Serbian army wherever he finds it and to open and ensure as soon as possible a land connection between Hungary and Bulgaria. Germany. also pledged to assist with whatever war materiel that Bulgaria needed, unless it harmed Germany's own needs. Bulgaria was to mobilize the four divisions within 15 days of the signing of the convention and furnish at least one more division outside of Mackensen's command and forces that was to occupy Vardar Macedonia. Bulgaria also pledged to keep strict neutrality against Greece and Romania for the duration of the war operations against Serbia, as long as the two countries remained neutral themselves. The Ottoman Empire was given the right to adhere to all points of the military convention, and Falkenhayn was to open immediate negotiations with its representatives. For its part, Bulgaria agreed to give full passage to all materials and soldiers sent from Germany and Austria-Hungary to the Ottoman Empire as soon as a connection through Serbia, the Danube, or Romania had been opened on the same day. Bulgaria and the Ottoman Empire concluded a separate agreement that granted Bulgaria the possession of the remaining Ottoman lands west of the river Maritsa, including a 2-kilometer stretch on its eastern bank that ran along the entire length of the river. This placed the railway to the Aegean port of Didiagach and some 2,587 square kilometers 999 square miles under Bulgarian control. The Allies were unaware of the treaty between Bulgaria and Germany, and on September 13 made a new attempt to gain Bulgarian support by offering the occupation of the uncontested zone by Allied troops as a guarantee that Bulgaria would receive it after it had attacked the Ottoman Empire. This offer, however, was a sign of desperation, and even the British foreign minister considered it inadequate. Radoslavov decided to play along and asked for further clarification on September 22. Bulgaria declared general mobilization, and Radoslavov stated that country would assume a state of armed neutrality that its neighbors should not perceive as a threat. This event was indicative of Bulgarian intentions and prompted the Serbians to ask the Entente to support them in a pre-emptive strike on Bulgaria. The Allies were not yet ready to help Serbia in a military way and refused, focusing their efforts instead on finding ways to delay as much as possible the seemingly imminent Bulgarian attack. Sazonov, angered by this Bulgarian betrayal, insisted that a clear ultimatum should be issued to the Balkan country. The French and the British resisted at first but eventually fell in line with the Russians, and on 4 October, the Entente presented an ultimatum demanding all German officers attached to the Bulgarian army be sent back to home within 24 hours on the previous day. A small Allied force had landed in Salonika. Radoslavov did not reply, and on 5 October the Allied representatives asked for their passports and left Sofia on 14 October. Bulgaria declared war on Serbia and the Bulgarian army invaded Serbian territory. British Prime Minister H. H. Asquith concluded that one of the most important chapters in the history of diplomacy had ended. He blamed this heavy Allied diplomatic defeat on Russia and most of all on Serbia and its obstinacy and cupidity. In military terms, Bulgaria's involvement also made the position of the Allies in Gallipoli untenable. The Bulgarian army organization and state of the army. The demobilization of the Bulgarian army following the formal end of the Second Balkan War took place under the difficult conditions created by the Ottoman military threat hanging over southern Bulgaria and the Romanian occupation of northern Bulgaria. Many of the divisions had to be brought down to their usual peace strength and redeployed to cover the Ottoman border. It was only after the signing of the Treaty of Constantinople that the army was able to complete the process of its demobilization and assume its peacetime organization. The old 9 regular infantry divisions were returned to their garrison areas. The 10th Aegean Division, that had been formed in the First Balkan War, was settled in the newly acquired territories in the Rhodope Mountains and Western Thrace. The 11th Infantry Division was reduced to minimal size and reformed into a cadre division used for the training of new recruits. On 8 December, the demobilization was completed and the peacetime army now comprised 66,887 men, out of whom 36,976 were in the interior of Bulgaria and 27,813 in the new territories in peacetime. The Bulgarian land forces consisted of 3 armies, 10 infantry divisions, 40 infantry regiments, 19 artillery regiments, 11 cavalry regiments, 5 battalions of engineers, 1 railway battalion, 1 telegraph battalion and 1 technical battalion. These forces retained the territorial organization established prior to the First Balkan War. The country was divided in 3 army inspectorates, 10 division districts and 40 regiment districts during wartime. The staff of each of these administrative units formed the headquarters and staff of a separate army, division and regiment. All male Bulgarian subjects were eligible to serve in the army when they reached the age of 20. At that age, they were considered conscripted for a period of 2 years in the infantry and 3 years in other branches of the active standing army. Following this period, a person was enrolled for another 18 years in the infantry or 16 years in other branches of the active army reserve. This reserve was the heart of the army, as it encompassed the bulk of the available manpower and reached a size of 374,613 men by the end of 1914. Finally, the men between 40 and 48 years served in the National Militia Narodno Opolcheni, which was divided in two bands. Initially, the first band was composed of men 41 to 44 years old and the second band was composed of men 45 to 48 old around 1914. Due to the experience of the Balkan Wars, the men between 45 and 46 years old that belonged to the second band were formed into separate ETAP troops by early 1915. The Bulgarian army could rely altogether on some 577,625 trained men aged 20 to 48. A special inquiry also determined that another 231,572 men were eligible for military service but had not received their training. Many of those were called up and received training in 1915. A Mannlicher M95 magazine rifle, the principal firearm used by the Bulgarian infantry since the end of the 19th century, was the Mannlicher magazine rifle, notably the M95 model but also the 1888 and 1890 models. Other rifles in use by the army include the Mosin Nagant 1891 model, the Burden II, and a number of Mauser rifles captured from the Ottomans during the First Balkan War. Officers were armed with a variety of pistols and revolvers, including the Parabellum 1908 and Smith 251,713 150,810,600 Mannlicher carbines, 9,513 1,781,800 187 Mosin Nagant rifles, 46,056 42,750,928 Burden rifles, 54,912 27,757,340 500 Mauser rifles, 12,918 11,188,860 Martini Mauser rifles, 3,614 900,250 captured Serbian rifles, 995 86,086 KRNKA rifles, 12,800 1,224,095 Parabellum 1908 pistols, 3,957 273,069 Smith 1,112 105,320 94 Maxim machine guns, 248 10,667,763 43,000 sabers, 19,000 A horse-drawn Schneider 75mm cannon. In 1915, the Bulgarian army had 428 quick-firing 75mm field guns. The artillery consisted of various field, mountain and fortress guns, most of it produced by the two world-leading manufacturers Schneider and Krupp. During the Second Balkan War, the Bulgarian army had lost a sizable quantity of its artillery, but by 1915 the country managed to recover its losses and even increase the number of available guns, so that by October 1915, the artillery park consisted of 1,211 pieces, of which 418 were not quick-firing guns. The